Good afternoon. It's an institutional and a personal pleasure to introduce Peter Bull this afternoon. Peter Bull is the Vice Provost for Advances in Learning and the Charles H. Carswell Professor of East Asian Language and Civilizations at Harvard University. As Vice Provost, he is responsible for Harvard X, the Harvard Initiative in Learning and Teaching. As the Professor of East Asian Language and Civilizations, his research is centered on the history of China's cultural elites at the national and local levels from the 7th to the 17th century. He's the author of numerous books, including This Culture of Ours, Intellectual Transitions in Tang and Song China, and also Neo-Confucianism in History. He has led Harvard University's wide effort to establish support for geospatial analysis in teaching and research, and in 2005, he was named the first director of the Center for Geographic Analysis. He also directs the China Historical Geographic Information Systems Project, a collaboration between Harvard and Fudan University in Shanghai, to create a GIS for 2,000 years of Chinese history. Also, in collaboration between Harvard, the Academia Sinica, and Peking University, Dr. Bull directs the China Biographical Database Project, an online relational database that currently has 360,000 historical figures that is being expanded to ultimately include all biographical data in China's historical record of the last 2,000 years. As I said, not only institutionally, but also personally, a pleasure to introduce Professor Bull. Long ago, when I was a graduate student, I actually read with him for a field in early modern Chinese history. What this basically meant is a small group of graduate students would get together, read a bunch of books, and then every couple of weeks meet with Professor Bull, be grilled mercilessly, but also find the experience to be but not only one of fear and trepidation, but of great expansion of our minds and learning, and something I remember with great fondness. So again, it's a pleasure to welcome him here to BYU, and I'll turn the time over to him to make his presentation.
Thank you. So thank you very much for having me here, and I'm sort of combining my interest in geography and online learning and China, and this part's be about China. So you recognize this dude in the middle. Does anyone know who he is? Xi Jinping, right? The chairman, the president, the all-powerful Xi Jinping at the moment. But many of you will not recognize the man who stands on his left. That is a man called Tang Yijie. He's a professor at Peking University. He was brought off of his sickbed to create this photo op for Chairman Xi. He's now passed away since. Tang Yijie is a leading scholar of Confucianism. So you might say, so Xi Jinping goes to Peking University and makes a point of calling up the eldest senior scholar of Confucianism to have this photo op with him. The fact that he was sick, not well, is irrelevant to that. He needed that photo op. So there's something going on here, right, that is all about politics, but it's also about scholarship and Confucian scholarship in particular. Now, Tang Yijie, one of his things that he launched, and of course one of the things the government is giving money for, is this enormous series of books on the history of Chinese Confucianism. And this is from the preface, right? Why have we compiled history of Chinese Confucianism? Because the Chinese people are currently in the process of their restoration as a great people. The restoration of a people necessarily is connected to the restoration of the people's culture. And the people's and Confucianism occupied the mainstream in our country's history, influencing all aspects of our country's social life. That is why the restoration of Confucianism is inseparable from the restoration of the Chinese people. This is the result of history. Well, another way of talking about Confucianism, we tend to talk about Confucianism, but another thing, a broader term, and more important in China today is actually guoxue, national learning. And this is from their website. In China, they like websites that are really crowded, as you can see. And up there in the upper left-hand corner, it says guoxue, xinzhi, national learning, new knowledge, and then under that, new national learning, new knowledge, new life. Right? So this is about values, it's about knowledge, it's about tradition, and it's about our tradition, our country's tradition. And this is not just limited to Confucianism. It includes, many people would argue, includes Buddhism, Taoism, includes literature, includes political theory, includes a vast array of things. But the notion is that our country has a national learning of some kind. Now, Confucius is part of that. This is actually a 17th century, rather sardonic image of Confucius, but this is a big conference that was held a number of years ago called Kongzi Yudangdai Zhongguo, Confucius and Contemporary China. This is a topic that people are talking about, but what do they mean by Confucianism? Right? Well, that preface I just read you makes two claims. It makes an historical claim that Confucius was the mainstream in our country's history. Well, whether that's true or not is something we can talk about. It's important, to be sure, but whether it was the mainstream for all people or just the elite, whether it was influencing all aspects of social life, or whether Confucianism, in fact, had been influenced by Chinese traditions of social life is another question. But there's also an ideological claim in that preface, that the restoration of Confucianism is inseparable from the restoration of the Chinese people to greatness. That's a claim made by people who believe that Confucianism is the be-all and end-all. But you could go down into the countryside in some parts of southern China and discover that the spread of Christianity or the spread of Buddhism is taking place far more broadly than the spread of Confucianism, so to speak. But Confucianism does have a special place, I think, in its sense that it is a... by the way, this is what I'm going to talk about today. And I've been reminded that this is like class time, so I can't go on for an hour and a half, 2 hours. We have to get done in time for you to be able to ask some questions. So I'm aiming to finish talking, doing my gig by 20 of the hour or 15 of the hour at worst. But I want to talk about four things. So what's Confucianism? Who is Confucius? Confucius is the first teacher. Confucianism is a certain kind of attitude rather than a doctrine, and then the present situation. But Confucianism is a problematic term. I think a lot of people in the West have used it to mean really the traditional Chinese social political system. But you could also use it to refer to an ethical system, you know, a family-first based ethical system. You could talk about it as a political system, the idea of the delegation of power, of centralized authority, unified political systems, but also the right of people in power to criticize the emperor. You could talk about it very effectively as a way of learning. And in fact, for most people, for most of history, Confucianism is not so much a social system or a political system as a way in which people learn. Learn in a broad sense, not like study for a class, but the kind of learning we do which transforms us as people. And it certainly is also a way in which intellectuals in the past, people with learning, people with knowledge, scholars in the past have tried to constrain people with political power and wealth. But who's Confucius? Well, it's certainly true also that every age has its own Confucius. But if you think about it, you know, there's, as far as I can tell, there's never been an emperor in Chinese history who was a Confucian. Emperors like to co-opt Confucianism, but it's not in their interest necessarily to be Confucian themselves because that would constrain them too much. The people who really want Confucianism are people who want to constrain those with power, right? The critics of those with power, who on one hand are justifying the political system, but also on the other hand are critics of it. And it's generally true that over history there's been many different kinds of Confuciuses. The first Confucius, the teacher of the Analects, but soon he became the editor of the Chinese classics. Then he became a philosopher who understood how heaven and man, or heaven and humankind, were connected. He was the sage who saw that order in the world depended upon individual moral cultivation. That's a later Confucius. Confucius as the source of social ethics. Confucius as the man who acquired learning from the past. Confucius as the uncrowned king who had a vision of the future, one of the most modern Confuciuses. It's over the last 1,000 years, there have been two major kinds of Confucianism, but very different. One, Neo-Confucianism, which grounded the idea of personal morality and moral autonomy in a notion of the way in which we are biologically connected to the universe, that we all share the same human nature, but we're not equal in the way we've realized it yet, but we can try to do that through learning. And then a different kind of Confucianism, Neo-Confucianism, appears in the 11th century, 17th century, late 17th century, we get a different kind, evidential learning, which rejects all these notions about cosmology and human nature, instead focuses on the methodology for studying culture. Right? Very different set of values. So if Confucianism can mean both those things, it's really hard to pin Confucianism down. It does seem to me that what Confucius has represented, we need to ask, why was it that every age needed a Confucius? Why is it that today needs a Confucius? Is in part because there were alternatives. There's Buddhist teaching, Taoist revelation. We now have Christianity appearing. But there was yet no monotheistic notion widely shared in China. Confucius gave China the notion of an antiquity, a past, a pure past, a golden age in antiquity that could be looked to in the present. But it served Confucius and his teachings, however they were construed at a certain time, served a very important need. It served the need to have something you could point to and say, why are you right or why are you wrong? A very simple but very basic thing. If we have a Bible or any other religious text that we can point to guide us, where we can say you can find the truth there, in Chinese history, what would it be? There was no one text. There are Taoist revelations, Buddhist sutras coming in, out of India, and that homegrown ancient version was the Chinese classics, the idea of Confucius as editor of the classics, and that provided people with something you could point to and say, this is a model, this is authority, but classics, as any ancient text, need to be interpreted. They never speak adequately for themselves. They have to be interpreted anew in every age. Let me move on to the question of, you can see I'm sort of rushing right through this, of Confucius as the first teacher. Now, if you think about Confucius himself, and this is the earliest Confucius, but in some ways it's the one that I think is most interesting and will be in the present, the one that saves the day and prevents Confucianism from becoming merely a tool of authoritarianism. Think about Confucius as a person, and what we know about him. He was a conservative aristocrat, but an aristocrat without much power, low level, orphaned when he was young. A failure by the standards of his own time. An outsider, marginal, never could find somebody who really wanted to employ him. But he believed in standing on principle. You know, when I first became a professor, I went to one of my senior mentors, a man I had known for many years, who I admired very much, and said, do you have any advice for me about going into this business you're in of being a teacher? And he said, yeah. He said, what you'll find in academic life is there are lots and lots of committees, and they'll absorb a lot of your time. You all know this, right? And so he said, when you go to your first committee meeting, stand on principle. They'll never ask you back. Because if you stand on principle, sometimes there are things that you will not do, you will not agree to, right? And Confucius was somebody who tended to stand on principle. It's no surprise that his students loved him and admired him because he stood on principle, but no one wanted to hire him. He was a pain, a thorn in their side. And he has a line where he says, his students are trying to persuade him, master, compromise, get along a little bit. You can have a great career. You could be important in politics, something like this. And they say to him, they give this model. They said, master, if you had a jewel at home hidden away in a box, would you keep it hidden away in the box the whole time, or would you bring it to the market and put it on sale? And Confucius said, oh, of course, I'd bring it to the market and I'd put it on sale, but I'd only sell it for the right price. And that's the problem, right? If the seller defines the price and the seller has the standards, you may have a hard time finding buyers. But Confucius knew something, or he thought he knew something. And what he knew was actually important. He believed that there was a path. There was a Tao. A path is, the Tao is something that has some interesting qualities. It begins somewhere and ends somewhere. You can always know whether you're on it or not, and you always know that people traveled it before. And Confucius said, there is a Tao, and it's from this Tao that we can know what's good. Socrates never could figure out in the Greek tradition what it was that was good. He'd ask people, and every argument he was given, he could counter. But Confucius, he knew. He knew what was good because he knew where he could find it. When you ask somebody usually, how do you know what's good? The answer they'll give you is not how they know, which is a psychological problem or philosophical problem of how one knows, but they'll answer where you know from. I know something from a certain book. I know from something from a certain teacher. I know something from experience. Well, where did Confucius know what was good from? He knew it from the past. In some sense, Confucius invented the notion of antiquity as an ideal. And he looked back to an antiquity, in this case, the founding of the Zhou dynasty in 1000 BC. Confucius lives around 500 BC. He's already looking back to something that's ancient to him. And he says, they had it, they had it. They found the path. And what was the path? And his answer is really depressing, not impressive at all. It's ritual. Ritual, right? What? How can ritual be the path, be the solution to everything? Well, if you think about ritual for a moment, you realize that there are lots of rituals in daily life. A commencement is a ritual. A marriage is a ritual. Going to church is a ritual. And if you think about that ritual asks us to play certain roles, and if you start to expand that notion of ritual to all society and social life, you pretty much get to some notion of an ideal world. But there's something else about ritual that's really important, and for that I'm going to need two volunteers. And they haven't been told ahead of time. I'm just pick two people, is that okay? And
if you would come up.
Yeah, you.
And okay, you stand over here, and I'm going to tell you what to do.
All right.
And, oh, what I'm going to show you is Confucian magic. And that's what you have to watch. Okay? By the way, could I ask one of you in the back to close the door? Yeah, thanks.
No. Hello, how are you?
Good. How are you?
Thank you very much. That's it.
So what was the magic? What was the magic? They shook hands. Yes, but why was that magic? Why was that magic? They both knew how to do it. That's part of the magic, so they must have had some cultural shared culture. Yeah. What's your name, by the way?
Gordon.
Gordon, and you're? Abby. So when Gordon shook Abby's hand, did he threaten her? Did he hold a knife to her throat? He didn't do any of those things, right? But he made Abby shake her hand and respond. That's magic, right? That it's a magic that comes from ritual. You can get other people to do things, right, simply by performing the right ritual. Now, I did something else. There was another piece of magic that I performed. I don't know if you saw it, but the two of them shook hands. That was one piece of magic. There was another very important piece of magic that took place. Did you see it? Yes?
She asked, how are you back?
That was, so even, be, yes, she did, and there was another thing of getting somebody's response, being able to wake that up. But there was another piece of magic I performed at the same time that didn't have anything to do to them. Yes?
You asked them to close the door.
I closed the door.
Yeah.
But you didn't. I did it by asking somebody to close the door. Tell me, if one of you in the audience had asked somebody to close the door, would it have happened necessarily? Maybe, maybe not. So the relationship between Gordon and Abby was equal, right? There's another kind of magic which is hierarchical, where you can ask somebody to close the door. We can actually can open the door again. That was just for the sake of a demonstration, if you want to, however. But both of those things work. A horizontal relationship and a vertical relationship. And part of the promise is if people with power act the way they should act, as Confucius said when he was asked, how do you govern a state? He said, easy. Let the ruler act like a ruler should act. The minister, this you know, high official act like the minister should act, and so on. That notion is, in fact, the very basis of ritual as government. And yet Confucius knew that, and pointed out that people used in diplomats and in political relationships, people used ritual to deceive each other, to usurp each other's authority, to undermine each other, that ritual was exactly what we think of it as in diplomacy, right? Somehow important yet meaningless, dishonest. It allows it to cover for politics, for power. And Confucius then brings to this a new notion of humaneness, of ren, that last word. The idea that in our actions, we have to be guided by a spirit of concern for the others as much as for ourselves. And what he says, basically, is you can't have ritual. Ritual can never be effective without humaneness. In other words, the spirit of ritual itself is concern for the other, along with concern for the self. And you have to have those two, that concern for other and self going on for ritual to work. And that's what makes Confucius the first follower, the first philosopher. He has a sense of values and where values come from. And you'll notice, too, that those values ultimately say that the social order depends upon the individual, not on the organization of power or the economy, but depends upon individual attitude and individual responsibility. I bring this up because this is a current that runs through Confucianism, but it's not necessarily the current that Xi Jinping is all that interested in, perhaps. Now, I want to move on to the notion of a Confucianism as a point of view. A number of years ago, when I first began to teach, I was at Harvard and was at a lunch table with a lot of people who worked on contemporary China, and I asked them, well, what is Confucianism in a sentence or two? And they all had a sentence or two answer to tell me what Confucianism was, each one of them a little bit different. And, you know, Confucianism is a social system, Confucianism is a political system, it's a dogma, whatever. And they asked, and they said to me, well, you study Confucianism, among other things. What do you think it is? And I said, well, I study it, so I don't know what it is. And they were really unhappy with that answer, because they expected me to have an answer to it. And so I thought about that. You know, to some extent, I've tried to say, well, it changes so much through time that you can't call it one thing, but maybe there is an attitude that distinguishes Confucians from lots of other people. And here I really draw on the Confucian philosopher Mencius from around the 3rd century, 4th century BC. And he has argued, by this point, when Confucius was alive, there was no other person. There weren't other philosophers for him to argue with. He doesn't even know he's a philosopher. But by the time, three generations later, when you're with the time of Mencius, he does know that there are other people with different arguments. And if he wants to defend a Confucian position, he's going to have arguments to counter those of others. And out of that, you know, you can sort of derive four major attitudes that I think are pervasive through all of Chinese history. So there are people who come to Mencius and say, you know, this is Muozi. He says, the solution to all our problems is for people to love each other equally. You know, you should never favor your own father. You should treat all fathers as your father. And all fathers should treat all children as their children, and then the world will be at peace because you won't privilege some against others, right? And so he has this radical egalitarianism that he puts forward, and Mencius says, well, you know, this isn't going to work because you've already assumed that they're fathers. And it's natural that people will care about their families somewhat more than other families. But what I think Mencius is getting to, and this is the larger Confucian attitude I think that's important here, is that society is real. You can't erase it. You can't make it go away. You may have the idea of a perfect society where family divisions disappear, social divisions disappear. It's not going to happen. There will always be that. And the question then is not, can we make society and social rules disappear and social hierarchies disappear? The question is, how can we make them just? How can we make them fair? How can we make them serve the interest of everybody? Somebody else comes along, this guy named Yang Zhu, and says, you know, everybody should be self-interested. And Yang Zhu is famous for saying, if I could save the world by plucking one hair out of my head, I would not do it. Because you have to ask, his logic is like this, if everyone acts in a totally self-interested way, eventually everybody will be making deals with each other and we'll all be okay. And I was talking about that once in a lecture, and there was a professor of economics, very fine professor of economics, who was sitting in on the lectures to learn about China, an economist. And she hears that line and said, oh, she said, that's right, that's an economist. You know, the notion of being self-interested can be a good thing, and there's an argument you can make for that. And Mencius says, you know, that notion of everybody acting in a self-interested fashion fundamentally is to deny that government is real, right? That everyone can act as an economic person and not as a political person. But government is real. Right? And in fact, if you think about it, if you go to, are there any economists in the room? Not many, apparently. You try to get people who work in political science and economic science together, they actually have totally separate worldviews. Right? And the economists can envision a world where there's no government, and maybe the political scientists can envision a world without economics, but I doubt it. But Mencius's point is that government is here to stay. You can't envision a system where there's no government. It won't work. Government will always be part of the story. And so the question is not, can you get rid of government? The question is, how can you make government fair? How can you make government just? The same thing with the economic order. Somebody comes to, I'm not following my own order here, but good. Somebody comes to Mencius who is a utopian. They're setting up communes. And he says to Mencius, you have all these good principles. You ought to be like us, right? And we share everything alike, and we're all equal, and we live in this wonderful society. We're a model for the whole world. And Mencius says, oh, really? And he says, yes, you know, everybody does the same thing. No one's the leader. No one's a follower. We all farm. We all work. And Mencius says, by the way, he says, I notice you're wearing a hat. Did you make that hat yourself? He said, no, I went to a weaver to get the hat. He said, by the way, when you cook your millet, what do you cook it in? He said, a pot. What kind of pot made of? Iron pot. He said, well, where do you get the iron pot? He said, oh, we traded for it with a blacksmith. At that point, Mencius has him. He says, well, there's no equality here. Right? We recognize the division of labor. And then Mencius takes it a step further and says, some work with their hands and some work with their minds. Right? Now, for Mencius, who's working with his mind, that's the right place to be. And actually, all academics would have to like that, I think. So, but the point that he's making is the division of labor, economic inequality, economic diversity is part of reality. And we can't make it go away. We can't have a utopia. So the question we as Confucians have to deal with is how do we make the economy function in a way that's fair? And finally, learning. You know, there are people at the time who say, and we see this with Zhuangzi and Laozi, the great Taoist philosophers, that culture doesn't matter. Culture is irrelevant. Language doesn't say what it means. Language is simply a vehicle. You can use it or not. Historical models from the past are irrelevant. You could look just as well to nature to find your models. And Mencius has to say to them, no, language actually can be used to say what you mean. Language can convey truths. Learning can be cumulative. Unlearning is not as good as learning more. And that is a debate that will always go on. Does learning matter? And the Confucian position definitely is that learning and culture matter. And that puts them somewhat at odds with spiritualists, with Taoists who believe that all you have to do is cultivate your physical life and everything will be okay. You don't need to learn stuff. With Buddhists who want to transcend and have sudden enlightenment and so on. Now, this gets me, my timing is better today, to the present. And let me say how I first got interested in Confucianism, because originally I was doing sort of a kind of social economic history, and then many years ago I'd finished my undergraduate school and I was in Taiwan studying, and I ended up studying with an old man who died just a couple years ago at the age of 107, who specialized in teaching, not at any university, but at home. And all of his students would come in the evening, were college students from local universities, and they'd listen to him lecture on the Confucian classics, the four books and the five classics. This is Shu Wujing. And I had been introduced to him, and one day he said to me, and I've been told that if he ever asks you to study with him personally, you have to say yes. It'll be the most extraordinary experience of your life. I've been told that by the same person who told me, when asked to serve on a committee, stand on principle, and you'll never be asked again. So, you know, good matter with good advice, obviously. And so this happened, and eventually I studied with him, and I started to study with him, I guess, 4 hours a day every morning for around two and a half, 3 years. Well, it was total study with him around 3.5 years. And we read all through the classics. And one day I asked him, motivated him in what he was doing. He wasn't rich. He lived, his students took care of him. His wife and family had been left on the mainland. He'd been brought to Taiwan under house arrest, I guess. And he said, well, he said, So in translation, he said, well, our youth today, they're very, this was in the 1970s, but it could be said today as well. The youth today is very confused in their hearts. And I said, why are they confused? He said, because they don't know how to be Chinese. They don't know what it means to be Chinese. And he said, I know. To be Chinese, you have to know the Tao. Sounds like Confucius, right? And where do you find the Tao? He said, you find the Tao in the classics. And that's why I teach the classics, so that they can know how to be Chinese. So here's 40 years ago now, in Taiwan, was somebody who was basically talking about what national learning means. Why we, to be Chinese, must have, for us to have a shared identity, we must have an intellectual foundation for it. And his answer was, the intellectual foundation was in the classics. And that's why this term guoxuan, national learning, which first became popular in the 1910s and 20s, and has been revived today, and is a major enterprise to every university now, a major university has a national learning institute, is both learning about our country and its history and culture, but it's also learning for our country, what our country should become. It's both of those things at once. And there are different strands in it. One is people like the philosopher Du Wei Ming, who is very much concerned with the moral individual. Others concerned with politics. There's a guy at Tsinghua University now who has an American collaborator named Daniel Bell, who has the notion of a Confucian constitutionalism, in which they'll have a House of Lords populated by descendants of Confucius. Very weird ideas. There's also a general education Confucianism. And this is a quote from Li Xueqin, one of the great scholars of China today. Says, "Guoxue de Julio shi Ruxue, Ruxue de Hexin shi Jingxue." The mainstream of national learning, he said, is Confucianism or Confucian learning, and the heart of Confucian learning is the learning of the classics. So again, in this case, somebody who wants to go back to texts to have a grounding for what it means to be Confucius. But there are other people, Chenping Yuan is an example, who believe that literature matters and that there's a style of literary learning. There are other people that believe that high historical scholarship is part of it. So what national learning is certainly not clear. But it does get at something that's very, very important, which is it possible to have a Chinese culture in the world today? Is that possible? If there's Buddhism there, Taoism, Confucianism, Christianity of various kinds of Christianity, Protestant, Catholic, in a world that's globalizing quickly, is it possible for there still to be a Chinese culture? And remember that the 20th century began with a rejection of the notion that there was anything of value in Chinese culture at all. And if you go into the 1960s, during the Cultural Revolution, into the early 70s, the notion that Confucius, that it was a futile, awful, futile person, and Mao Zedong launched an attack on the four olds. Everything old was to be destroyed. They went into family compounds, and they took out the ancestor portraits, and they burnt them. And they took the family genealogies and burnt them. And they destroyed all the religious statues they could find with the Red Guards. That was only 40 years ago. So the idea that there should be a Chinese culture, something distinctive, something other than Marxism, Leninism, or communism, that's had to be revived, right? Because it was being denied. And that's the big question. That's a question, in some sense, that national learning is asking and Confucianism is asking. There's another way of thinking about that, that through the 20th century, into the 21st century, people tend to think in terms of modernization. China needed to modernize. And modernization said there was one path along which countries should develop. The West had gotten there first, and thus the West provided the models.
Japan bought into this as well, believed strongly in modernization. Marxism-Leninism is all about modernization. It's the idea of progress and a set course of historical progress that has to be followed. Globalization goes in a very different direction. Right? We could talk about economic globalization, which is how people mostly think about it, as you know, different countries, China provides cheap labor, America provides advanced capitalist banking and so on, and different countries can provide different things in the global economy. But there's another kind of cultural globalization which says that we don't all have to be on the same path. Different cultures can find different ways. We can look to find the right way for us in China, and we as Chinese have a responsibility to offer the world something the world does not have, something that we had because we developed it in our history. And that, it seems to me, is something that has come up again and again. We have our antiquity. It's different from the antiquity of the Judeo-Christian Bible, of Adam and Eve. It's a different cultural history. It's a different trajectory. And it has been a touch point in China's history before the outside world, whether it was Buddhism first in the 3rd, 4th century, or the West in the 19th and 20th century, provided. Now, there are people in China who look at national learning and see that as a defense of Chinese exceptionalism and Chinese uniqueness. You may not, some of you may remember this, but in 9/11, right? September 11th. Lin Cheney, who was then the head of the National Endowment for the Humanities, husband was a guy named Dick Cheney, said, let no one reach the conclusion after the events of 9/11 that this means we should know more about the Islamic world. Let no one conclude that. She said, the proper conclusion to reach after 9/11 is that we have to learn more about America and be better Americans and do more with Americanism. So that's a Chinese point of view of a certain political, of a conservative sort in China. In fact, I think that extreme conservatives in both China and the United States could form a perfect union together sometimes. This notion that we are exceptional, we are unique, there's no need for us to look outside because everything we have is right here. And what I tell my Chinese friends when I start to hear them talking about how exceptional China is that this is really good because there are people in America who believe that America is exceptional, and so both of you have exceptionalism as a common belief, which makes you not exceptional at all. I think the question in China is whether what this national learning is going to become. And I don't think it's decided at all, but I think it's something you all need to pay attention to as time goes on. Is it going to be a pillar of authoritarianism? Or is it going to be something else? Is it going to be an alternative universalism to Western liberalism, for example, or to communism? It's interesting that I have Chinese students who think that what is going on is this, is that the Communist Party has recognized that Marxism-Leninism will not survive. If it's not going to survive, what's the basis for rule in China? Well, Western liberalism would be one, liberal democracy. And they are universal human rights, things like this. They are not, it's very clear that the party apparatus rejects that. And you can read them, you know, journal articles denying it. And that Confucianism appeals to people like Xi Jinping because it provides an alternative. We will need, this is planning ahead, we will need a new intellectual foundation. Where are we going to find it? Better that we find it in China than we find it abroad. I think find it in China is a fine thing because it does not have to be exceptionalism. And there are voices in China today that say, particularly liberal voices, that say, Confucianism is an alternative universalism. And that, of course, was the role it played in the past, that it was a way of learning, a way of thinking about values of ritual and humaneness that could be shared beyond its own borders. And perhaps an indication of this This is questions from a university entrance exam. And I'd like you to look at those questions and see if you could apply them to all Harvard or BYU freshmen, and how many of us would pass this examination. So the expectation here is both a knowledge of Chinese culture and a knowledge of the West. So it begins with a question, Kant and Marx say they are people of the world. Why do they say that? What do they mean by that? You're asked to compare Confucius and Socrates. Well, maybe you know Socrates. How many of you could do the comparison to Confucius? Question, is it acceptable to criticize Confucius? Apparently, I hope this answer was yes. Is there an alternative to the philosophy of struggle, which is a Marxist-Leninist idea? Is there a philosophy of harmony, going back to the 11th century philosopher Zhang Zai? How about private property? Is private property okay? Protection of it okay? Then a question on aesthetic, to talk about aesthetic education based on Beethoven. I couldn't answer that question. Who are the representative Russian writers and their works, including Solzhenitsyn? Talk about the Book of Odes, one of the Confucian classics. What were the ideas of John Locke, the first great liberal economist? Tell us the major ideas of Montesquieu, the French philosopher. Do you know about the Universal Declaration of Human Rights from 1948? How about the 1911 railway protection movement in Sichuan? And why did the Soviet Union collapse? Right? If Chinese students are being expected to have this level of knowledge coming out of high school, I don't worry too much about China. But what Confucianism will be and what China will become is still, I think, an open question. So thank you very much. We have a little bit of time for questions.
So again, we'd invite you just to form a line here, use the wireless mic, tell us your name and what you're studying, and please, we have a few minutes for questions.
Now, you all got to ask some questions, because otherwise I'm going to end up being embarrassed. So, good, there we go. A victim.
Hi, I'm Ruby. I'm a Korean studies major at BYU. And we've talked about Confucianism. I'm taking Eastern religions class right now. We talk about Confucianism. And what I understand is that Confucius developed Confucianism and had this ideological thought because of the political chaos of his time. So if there is a return to Confucianism, do you think there would have to be some sort of political uproar?
No, I don't think so, because I think that the great redefinitions of Confucianism in Chinese history have happened at various moments. You're certainly right that Confucius is idealizing antiquity in contrast to the divided warring state, the warring
yes.
states of his present. But I don't think that's a necessary condition for a new kind of Confucianism. I think a sense of crisis is, a sense that there are challenges that have to be met is.
Mm.
Definitely, you're right in that point.
Right. Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Ashley Barlow. I'm studying English language. And I was just wondering if you had any ideas about how we can have more of a national education here in America to try and continue with that.
So this is a really good question, right? Because the idea of a national learning, of national education, is based on the need, the perceived need for a national identity. In a world where Chinese identity has been, the notion of a Chinese identity has been suppressed and traditional culture has been suppressed. It seems to me that those conditions don't pertain in America. We haven't had too many worries about national learning. And if you look at today where, you know, this notion of a core curriculum, national standards for education to raise the level of education in America, which has so clearly started to fall behind many other industrialized countries, how that's become politicized. The idea that we could have a national education seems to me to be politically impossible. Anyway.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Hi. My name's Abe Collier. I'm studying philosophy. And I was wondering, could you talk for a moment about the balance between Confucianism and communism? I feel like there's some tension there, and I'm wondering how much do you think there will be, and how much can the two work together, and how much are they going to have to kind of fight it out for who has dominance?
So I think you're quite right. There's real tension there. So if you look at where at national funding for philosophy, right, it goes in two directions. Marxism-Leninism on one hand, so all these socialist education institutes and Marxist-Leninist institutes, and national learning and Confucianism on the other. Communist Party magazines take and opinion pieces, and this is Chaucer, for those of you, the official organ of the Communist Party, that said this. He says, well, you know, we know that Western values are bad. We know that universal human rights is a bad idea, that this is Western imperialism. And Confucianism is okay, but it has problems too. There's only, you know, Marxism-Leninism is still the right way. And of course, Chinese point out that Marxism-Leninism is a Western idea as well. But there is a tension. I think that many universities, many academics look at the government's willingness to patronize Confucianism as a good thing. It's good for them because it gives money to their universities and their enterprise. I suspect that Marxism-Leninism is not going to survive in China. And the question then is, what's the role going to be of national learning, not just Confucianism, and how is it going to be defined? Because there's not going to be a single political way that it gets defined. And I don't think there's a consensus yet in what it's going to mean.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Sierra. I'm an Asian Studies major. Oh. And I was just wondering, this whole national learning thing is very, very linked with national identity. And I'm just wondering how minority ethnic groups in China feel about
that's
all
a
of
very
this?
Good question, because the Confucian position on this from very early on was let them be separate. If minorities, if border peoples want to join us and enter our culture, welcome them. If they want to leave, let them go, but don't force them. So the Confucian position traditionally is anti-imperialist. It doesn't mean the government, remember, don't conflate Confucians with the Chinese government, past or present. The government tends to be imperialist, but Confucian scholars tend to be critics of imperialism because they say, how do you deal with people of different cultures coming in? It's a very serious problem today. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Jerem, and I'm studying political science. And I was wanting to ask, from your observations, do you feel like the culture in China of families and parents in the home, is that an active thing to teach the things that are here on this like entrance exam to more of the liberal arts and things like that? Is that part of the culture of families?
I don't think that will help with this, unless your parents know a lot about John Locke and Kant and things like that. But I think, though, that it's a very interesting phenomenon that you put your finger on something that's important, which is for many people, Confucianism is the notion of honor your father and mother, filial piety, family obligations, family duty, and that sort of, there's this core ethics that sums it up. And that certainly is part of Confucianism. Because why are family ethics so central to Confucianism? Because that's where the individual begins. You begin first in your relationship with your family, right? And so that's, if there's going to be moral training, that's where it has to begin. But it's not enough. You don't get from that to this. And that would have been true in the past as well. But what we have seen is a government that's willing to try to say, can we write this into law, right? Can we say that all children have an obligation to take care of their parents? Can we put you in jail for not taking care of your parents? And there have been moves in that direction. It's an interesting thing. One of the things that Confucians decided early on was that ritual and law were antagonistic, right? Ritual was good and people should have it, but to try to turn it into law was to miss the point, because law is about coercion. And unless people act from their own heart, they cannot do good, right? But the government has always been about coercion. It makes people pay taxes, it makes them go into the army, fights wars, and so on. So there's this fundamental tension in Chinese society between notions of morality and notions of political expediency. The other cynical view of what the government was doing is the government doesn't have the money to pay for social welfare, so it wants to hold people responsible and transfer the risk to individuals.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Gentry Carter. I'm a public relations major. I was wondering if you could comment on, so there was kind of like the underlying premise that we wanted a Confucius, or like people want a Confucius in order to like establish this national learning. But at the same time, you make the point that there is no actual definition of Confucianism. And so what's the relation between trying to find that like almost a zeitgeist of learning and the fact that you can't?
Yes, isn't that a wonderful conundrum to be in? Yeah, it's a very good question, very good question. What has happened in the past is that consensus, there have been, we go back to various periods, I think the 11th century is one, the second century BC is one, the 17th century, late 17th century is another, where there's been a lot of debate about what, is there a shared way of learning that we as intellectuals and as elites should have? And which could be said to be an argument about Confucianism. And it begins with debate and lots of different points of view, but in those cases, there also is a consensus that emerged. And we don't, I guess what I'd say today is I don't know what the consensus will be. I think it will emerge. I think one will emerge, probably, but I don't know what it's going to be because everything's open at the moment.
All right, do you have like any idea when it will emerge?
I think that it's it really, you know, the revival of national learning issues really began in the 1980s.
Right.
So I think it's going to go hand in hand with the collapse of the power of the Communist Party.
Okay.
Because that will force the issue.
Right.
Right? What is it that we share? And so let's say I'll be dead, but you'll still be alive. So you figure it out then. 20 years or so.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you, and thanks. Lots of thanks, Professor Bull, for his talk.